She's one of the most mysterious and well-known women in the world. Tonight, meet Yoko Ono and hear her reminisce about life with Lennon.
Now, John is a different person now. In a way, what he means to the world is much greater than when we were living together.
These female bodybuilders are trying to prove that their physiques have flex appeal and that muscles can be feminine.
Actress Jane Wyman talks about Hollywood, Falcon Crest, and an ex-husband. His name was Ronald Reagan. All that coming right up tonight on Monday's edition of Evening Magazine.
From a little bit of Canada on the Boston Common, good evening to you. I'm Barry Nolan.
And I'm Sara Edwards, and behind us is the Christmas tree that was given to the children of Boston by the children of New Brunswick, Canada. Last night was the traditional Light of Light ceremony. Today, some of the festivities have still been going on with storytelling, and it really is a measure of goodwill and friendship.
Our first story tonight is about a man who asked people to imagine that the world could live as one. It's the story of John Lennon, as seen through his work on the eyes of his wife, Yoko Ono.
He represented more than just his music. He represented many of the ideals of his generation. John Lennon was a voice for concerns that were both universal and timeless. But towards the end of his life, his most central concerns were the ones that he would embrace on a daily basis. He was a devoted father and husband. Recently, Yoko Ono was in Boston for the opening of This Is My Story, Both Humble and True, a collection of drawings by John Lennon. During her visit, she gave us some insights into his sketches and their lives.
Without even knowing what he was like in private, his words and his music and his message and his drawings and his writings, because he was a Renaissance man, I think they all help people, and his products are something that's worth sharing. And through that sharing, we're a family.
Is this a way of making your relationship continue to be a reality for you?
Maybe. Well, ask my psychiatrist. No, I don't have one. But, well, that's a good analysis, maybe. But because there was no point in just sort of wallowing in pain after what had happened. And especially for Sean's sake, I really have to get myself together and start to just walk into the future. So I felt that the only way I can do that is through work. And then gradually I started to look into his work as well, and felt that these are works that I want to share with the world.
When I was younger.
Well, these are John's lithographs, and this is my favorite, it happens to be. And the lines are very interesting. It's very flowing, and it's just done in one brushstroke, and it just makes such a sense. I mean, it's not just three-dimensional, it's four-dimensional, you know? And that's what's so unique about it.
It's interesting to hear you talk about John. I mean, you still get a great sense of love.
I get a great kick out of it. I mean, the point is, really, because as an artist myself, I really respect his work. And so it's a pleasure. This is a sketch of the bed-in, the famous bed-in. And we were in bed, and these are the reporters, and that's how he saw it. From his eyes. It was a fun time, and also it was a time that we were really communicating with people. And happens to be our honeymoon. I mean, this wasn't the way that I wanted to spend my honeymoon. But
how long a period of time did this work cover? Was it all in a fairly condensed period that he was doing this work? Or?
No, not really. Well, condensed, if you say a decade is condensed, you know, it's relative. I think that starting with 1969, around that time, ending with 1980. In the end, when we did the Double Fantasy record, and the cover was me and John, and we were kissing, And somebody advised us that because he's a pop star and the album has to sell, so let's not have a kiss scene, let's have him looking like a bachelor, you know. And so I reported to him that, and he just laughed and said, from now on, let's skip only pictures when you and I are looking at each other, never looking at the world.
In one of his last interviews, John Lennon said, to me, the best poetry is haiku. All the best paintings are zen. The less said, the better. I would like to say it without lyrics, but I can't. I'm just verbal. Somehow, it is clarity that I'm looking for. Clarity of expression. If you try.
That huge figure of John Lennon in your life that's directly behind you, sometimes does it seem like it's a lot to carry around?
Now John is a different person now. In a way, what he means to the world is much greater than when we were living together. And I think that his image and his spirit and his influence is very good for the world. And so he's bigger than life now, literally. So in that situation, if I'm in the shadow of him, well, it's a nice shade to be in. And I treasure the experience. You may say I'm a dreamer,
but I'm not the only one. It was 6 years ago today that one of the brightest lights in the world of music was extinguished forever. This is the sixth anniversary of the death of John Lennon. His lithographic work is still available at Marlboro Gallery down on Newberry Street, and his music and its influences, you can hear that everywhere you turn. Coming up next, a man who is trying to turn the sport of bodybuilding in a new direction, and later on, Jane Wyman talks about a fascinating past.
Last week, I interviewed a model for Evening Magazine. You'll see the story in a couple of weeks. The model was from France, and her name was Inez. She models exclusively for the House of Chanel. She stood about 5'10", weighed 120 pounds. She was beautiful, but I couldn't help compare her figure to that of American models. Their style is much different. They are lean but muscled. After all, fitness has become such a permanent part of our American lifestyle. Right now, we are going to meet some models who have taken muscles even a step further. Evening's Ray Murray has the story.
This could very well be an idea whose time has come. Theatrical bodybuilding, a novel way to present the finely toned muscles of today's top female bodybuilders. For the women of the sport, it's a golden opportunity to express the range of their talent and address the sport's biggest problem, its image. Show director Chichi Valente.
Women's bodybuilding is so in its infancy, and since it had to come out like Adam's rib out of men's bodybuilding, you had a very male aesthetic applied to it, and you have a lot of men directing it. But what's going to be really special about women's bodybuilding has to be more what comes from the specialness of women.
No one believes that more than Brian Moss, founder of Better Bodies Model Management. Several years ago, Brian decided women's bodybuilding needed to reach a higher ground. So he began what is now an annual charity event, the theatrical presentation of his top talent.
I think if you look at bodybuilding in a historic sense and in terms of the way the public perceives the sport right now, it's looked upon as being in somewhat the Stone Age. The presentation is really critical, and the public needs to perceive it in a way that's more acceptable than the way it's been.
It's the women of bodybuilding that have struggled most with the image problem. From the day they entered the sport, they have had to face the question, how can a woman be both strong and powerful, yet feminine at the same time?
Some people think that women bodybuilders have this inside desire to be men. I'm always very surprised. I really don't know how to try to convince people that I don't want to be a man.
Oh, you know how it is. You're not supposed to be muscular, and you'd walk down the street and the kids would all make fun of you. Oh, there's muscle lady. The guys on the gymnastics team wouldn't go out with me because my arms were bigger than theirs. So it was a problem. It really was.
What's
But it's slowly becoming less of a problem with the addition of more women to the sport and the new settings in which they're seen.
Used to seeing models and women who are lean, you know, beautiful faces, and basically their bodies are silhouettes, and the clothes dress them up. But what happens when the body dresses the clothes up? You know, that's what bodybuilding is.
And what happens when bodybuilders take that one step further and allow the clothes and the body to develop as living sculpture? That was the idea behind the benefit performance at New York's Limelight Disco.
In one word, the show is a pageant. And in the old sense of Cecil B. DeMille movies and a sense of people larger than life taking on the form of a goddess or a god, and something that these bodies really lend themselves to. I am all muscle.
It's exactly like acting. You read a script, here's your character, this is your role, and you gotta portray that person.
You know that people aren't expecting you to be you. So that gives you the freedom to kind of step out of your own personality and into someone else's for that little bit of time and entertain people.
Perhaps shows like this will bring bodybuilding into its own art form, where it can have both flex appeal and mass appeal outside the gym and away from competition.
Massachusetts has its share of model bodies. As a matter of fact, Diane Vecchione is one of the leading bodybuilders in the state. She's the American Athletic Union's reigning Miss International and Miss Massachusetts. And she works out regularly in Stoneham at her husband's gym. That's called Joe's Gym. By the way, she says she loves her muscles. She says they're a great conversation piece at parties. Coming up next on Evening Magazine, an actress who's a tough character on the set and off. Jane Wyman, when we continue.
So this tree is the permanent living gift to the city of Boston from New Brunswick, is that right?
That's right. It was transplanted here this fall, and it stands next to the big tree that they use for the light ceremony. And one day when this tree grows big and tall, it will replace the other tree.
It's a nice kind of tradition. Do you have a Christmas tree tradition in your family?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Out in Southern California, my family has always had flocked trees.
Are we talking like birds or what's
flocked? We're talking about spraying that fake snow on a tree. So I come home, having lived in New England now, and I go home and it's 80 degrees outside and they have a snow-covered tree in the living room. It's strange.
That's Southern California. So here, of course, you know we put grapefruit juice on our trees.
Right.
Well, here's a story by Evening's Marilyn Beck about a woman who makes her home in California who has had a very interesting family life with some remarkable twists and turns.
Jane Wyman is nothing like the pitiful, long-suffering women she portrayed so successfully in the 40s and 50s. Nor is she vindictive and mean like the character she plays on Falcon Crest.
You're up to no good.
I've neglected you terribly.
Yes, you have.
Do you ever get tired of being mean and conniving on the show?
Well, you know, when I go home, I leave her right here in this dressing room. So I don't have her when I'm home. And when I come back in the morning, the girls say, have you painted her on yet? You know, like you put the makeup on and you get your hair all done and whatnot. And I said, yeah. Then when I finish, she's locked up. So I don't really get bored with her because she has so many funny facets about her.
Yes.
I mean, you know, it's not just all mean. And this year, she has opened up a great deal in different directions.
Quiet, please. Here we go.
Throughout her career, Jane has been considered the consummate professional. She's never late for work and always knows her lines. Jane admits she has little patience for people who aren't as professional as she is. In fact, when some of her co-workers were late for work, Jane made it clear their tardiness was inexcusable.
I wish I had more patience with some of the younger people, you know, but how are they going to learn unless somebody kind of guides them along? And so I just stay right in there and say, look, this is the way it can be done. Now, if you don't want to do it that way, that's okay, but this is the way it can be done. And three quarters of the time, they'll say, well, I never thought of that. You know, they're very willing.
But yet, you have had people come on that show that
yeah.
you were impatient with me.
Not only impatient, but they're not there.
You helped get rid of them.
All I could do.
Really?
Yes, I did. Because it was just, our schedules were going crazy, and nobody knew what they wanted them to do, and it was just, it was bad. It was just bad management, you know?
Oh, Peter. Boy, it's magnificent.
Jane takes acting seriously and feels that other actors should do the same. She says she learned the hard way how important discipline is when she was a young starlet at Warner Brothers in the mid-30s.
When you were first starting out, were you ever disciplined?
Oh, by all means. I'm disciplined by the best directors in the world.
What did you do wrong?
Oh, I was joking when I should have been serious, for instance. Like, you know, I'm making fun of my part, or I'm just making this up as it goes on, but it's something in the thing. And finally, I saw a director, Brick Enwood, who is not with us anymore, God love him, and he was sitting behind that camera, and he gave me a look I will never forget in my whole life. And I went over to him, and do you know that for two solid weeks he wouldn't talk to me? He said, you know, this isn't fun. We're in it because this is a form of art, and if you want to learn it, and, ooh, he just laid me out cold. And you know I never did that again.
Jane learned early the ways of the studio publicity departments. In the 40s and 50s, it wasn't unusual for the studios to embellish stars' biographies when the real ones weren't too exciting. Such was the case when Sara Jane Folks from St. Joseph, Missouri became Jane Wyman.
They even had my father, the mayor of St. Joe, Missouri, even though the mayor of St. Joe.
Well, now wait a minute.
He was the chief of detectives, but he was never the mayor,
That's
you know.
Right.
And,
Did they change your age or try
yeah,
to?
Yeah, they changed my age.
Now, did you change it back?
No, then? I can't change it back. I don't pay any attention to it, but I can't change it back because it's been in print for 50 years. What am I going to do with it?
Well, you want to set the record straight?
No, I do not want to set the record straight. But, I mean, they did invent so much. Ooh. And then when I'd go out, like, for instance, Marilyn, if you were in New York and I were going to be interviewed by you in New York, and you would ask me certain questions about my background, such as St. Joe, Missouri, I'd look at you as if you had four heads because I'd never heard of this stuff.
Jane's discipline finally paid off in 1949 when she won an Oscar for her performance in Johnny Belinda. However, her personal life was less than rosy. She and Ronald Reagan divorced after 8 years of marriage, leaving Jane to raise their son Michael and daughter Maureen.
Michael has said that he and Maureen were raised by nannies and nurses. Did you ever feel any guilt about that?
Those kids, they're something. Of course I had a nanny. I've had a nanny since they were born, you know. And the kind of work that we were doing in those days, I never knew when I was going to be in New York. I didn't know where I was going to be half the time. So I had a marvelous craft staff at home that knew exactly what I wanted done. And kids are funny. They always have to have something to say. And I think that in this case, it's probably something to say. And maybe when he wanted me there at that particular time, even though I went to the football game that he played in the day before, and he wanted it there, and I wasn't there, well, dear, isn't that just too bad? I don't think they've suffered, believe me. I'm one of them.
Jane virtually quit show business in 1962. She came out of retirement to do Falcon Crest. Jane takes an active part in many of the show's production decisions, but says she has to be careful not to be too critical, especially about herself.
I wish I were not so intense at criticizing myself, because I pick myself apart sometimes, and sometimes I'm not guilty, you know? So that's one thing that I just have to work on all the time.
Even if she had never become famous as an actress, Jane Wyman's place in history was assured because she was, of course, the first wife of President Ronald Reagan. Reportedly, one of the reasons she left Reagan at the time was he was just so darn interested in something silly like politics. Don't go away, we'll be back with more of Evening Magazine in just a moment.
Have you ever talked to a
every night. Just kidding, Vera.
Pretty funny for a dummy.
Valerie and Robin Kahn, who are ventriloquists and storytellers and are performing throughout the Boston area this holiday season for kids at places like Children's Hospital, which is great.
Hey, if you'd like to do your bit for the kids over at Children's Hospital and have some fun at the same time, tomorrow night we're going to be involved in a charity basketball game against Saga Tours.
That's at the Roberts Athletic Center at Boston College at 7:30. I'll be cheerleading. Barry will be playing. I hurt my elbow, remember?
excuses. No excuse, though, for missing a great time tomorrow night. All proceeds go to help the kids and children. Some great door prizes for you, too.
And some good stories for you all this week on Evening Magazine. Tomorrow night, we talk to the bad boy of tennis, John McEnroe, about his love match with Tatum O'Neal.
Wednesday, the founder of the Hard Rock Cafe chain, home of the Jet Setters.
On Thursday, we'll catch up with the legendary Osmond family. Donnie and Marie say they've gone through a lot of changes.
And Friday, in our national poll, the subject is teenagers. Hope you join us.
Good night, everybody.
Take care.
Country Western and pop star Kenny Rogers talks about his wife, his son, and his continued success tomorrow at 9 on The Oprah Winfrey Show.